I had made a phone call after this goes back to the earthquake. If you remember, and your listeners remember, we used to have, or maybe they still make them, memory phones. These were phones that had buttons, sometimes 10, 15 buttons. And you'd put a piece of paper under the plastic and it would say, okay, Dan's phone number, my brother's phone number, the grocery store, whatever. Well, in the earthquake, the phone was thrown against the wall, cracked. And for whatever reason, every number but one, the tabs, the pieces of paper fell out. So when I finally got back in my condo, I started to dial the buttons. I had this phone for years, so I didn't know who was who. And I dialed one, and my brother answered, hey, Randy, you know, how you doing? I'm just testing the phone. I put the, you know. Anyway, I finally get to this this number, and I don't recognize the voice. Kind of a sexy voice, but a nice girl, you know. And she says, who are you? I'm like a pervert calling, right? She says, who are you? Well, it may have made a difference. This was 2 a.m. So I said, well, my name is Jamie. And she says, well, Jamie, I've been getting phone calls for you for 10 years. I said, what are you talking about? She says, I don't know. You seem to know a lot of people. She said, there's girls calling from South America, and there's guys and people leaving messages for you and work calls. And she said, you're a musician, right? Yeah. So anyway, we explain it. And within days, we're now on AOL writing emails to each other. And then I just had a feeling about her, a great feeling about her. Loved her voice, you know.
And she ended up in your phone accidentally? It was like a wrong number kind of thing?
Well, this is the thing. So the number was the number I had 15 years prior when I was married.
Oh, it was your old phone number.
My old phone number.
Oh, wow.
So the whole thing is just crazy, right? So we're talking, and I call her up at 4 a.m. in the morning, which is, I don't know who I was then. And I said, look, I'm really not a weirdo. I'm not stalking you. I'm not a pervert. I just want to talk. I remember this. And she stayed on the phone. We stayed on the phone for 2 hours, you know. And anyway, Helen says, I want to meet you. And I refused. And the reason why I refused was, indeed, I had a stalker before. I met a lady in Switzerland who somehow showed up at my doorstep claiming she was my wife. Mm. And my landlord, property owner, let her into my apartment. I had to get the Los Angeles Police Department and INS to get her out of the country.
Wow.
And it was very scary. There was more to that story. I don't want to do it on the radio. But because of that experience, I didn't want to meet Helen. And so I decided that this is not working because I like her. Mm-hmm. I want to meet her. I don't have a girlfriend. Okay. So I went to my apartment condo, which had all balconies in the front, and I gave everybody $5. All the people. I said, I need your help. You all know I was stalked by this lady. I want to meet this woman I've been on the phone with. Here's $5. Please come out on your balcony. Everybody took the money like crazy. You know? So I went door to door. Here's $5. All you need to do is go on the balcony. If I give you the thumbs up, then you could go in. So everybody agreed. In fact, I don't think there was one person who had to work, but the rest of everybody was, yeah. So anyway, I tell Helen, show up. So we have a time. She says, I'm leaving now, and I'm waiting outside for this woman who I've never seen. And she pulls up, and I am blown away. I just love what I see, right? And so I give everybody the thumbs up. Everybody goes in their building. And Helen looks at me, and she says, what was that about? You know, I don't even know this woman, right? And I said, well, I'll explain this sometime in the future to you. And anyway, we 2 weeks later, my lease was up, and she needed a roommate, a tenant, in a beautiful house that she still has, actually. And I moved in.
So as you said, you know, your mother had serious health issues, you know, including an unfortunate instance of receiving tainted blood in a transfusion, which really took a toll on her, made a bad situation worse. It sounds like despite all that, you know, she still found a way to maintain a positive attitude. You know, unfortunately, her health problems contributed to the added burden of financial problems for your father, as it always does, relating to medical bills. So you think both of them would be all gloom and doom, you know, not the sunny optimism, you know. And, you know, this is just the speculation of an outsider who wasn't there. You take it for what it's worth. But I suspect, you mentioned your mom died when you were 14. If she didn't have you and your brother, you know, giving her something to focus on and making her feel loved and needed and appreciated, it's possible she might not have made it as far as she did.
Yes, I know. I completely agree with you. And, you know, I have a world of students. I teach online. I've taught for years with a lot of people who don't have supportive parents at all. And in fact, I have one quick story, a guy named Rocky George. He was a really good little guitar player, and he was studying with me in California, coming every week. And his parents didn't want him to make a career of playing. And one day he called me up on the phone. He said, can I move in with you? And now, this is a little bit strange because, for one thing, no. The answer, of course, is no. He was a student, a paying student. So the first thing I think of is, well, he wants free lessons, you know. anyway, he called to move in, and because his parents threw him out of his house because he refused to go to school to become a doctor. His parents were going to pay for this. And since he decided he would be a musician, they threw him out. And that's why he needed a place to stay. Anyway, he stayed at my house for 2 or 3 days and so forth. About a month later, I get a CD in the mail, or a record in the mail, with a big thank you to Jamie Glaser for his love and support and lessons. It turned out Rocky became the guitar player in a band called Suicidal Tendencies.
Oh, wow. Awesome.
And went on to great success. In fact, he's the first musician I ever met who had an endorsement with Marshall amplifiers. Even Hendrix didn't have an endorsement until very late.
I really hate to interrupt you, but I got to say, here's how I first heard of you. Uh-oh. Back in the 80s, when everybody's playing Marshall, Dan was the one guy in town who played a Randall.
All right.
And then I remember the ad of you, the print ad of you, and it said, you know, Jamie Glaser, Jean-Luc Ponty guitarist playing a Randall. I remember the image. I didn't remember the name. So then, you know, just in the last year or so, I went back and through the magic of the internet, it was still there. I go, how serendipitous is that? I go, this is the dude, Jamie Glaser, with the Randall amps, man. We have that connection. That's like 1982, man.
Too bad this isn't a TV show. I'd show you that I still have two Randalls. In fact, one, the guy who developed the RG80, which was the model I used, is a fellow named Gary Sunda, good guitar player. He owns a speaker company in Tustin, California now. And Don Randall and Leo Fender had gotten together when they broke apart. Mm-hmm. He designed this Randall. And I indeed was the first endorser of Randall before Def Leppard, before a lot of people. And their support was unbelievable. And still to this day, I was just at the NAMM show, you know, of course, in January. First person I saw was Gary. And he's going to take my Randalls, and I have a little buzz in one of them. And
I went to the music store in Sacramento, you know, shopping for amps, you know, and I'd never heard of it. I'd never seen it before. It costs less than the Marshall half stack. I plugged it. I said, you know, this sounds pretty good. I mean, like being different. I like having a slightly different axe or slightly different amp or slightly different pedal than other people. So I just took a shot. I had worked all summer at my father's surveying company, summer job. And and I think I made like $800 and I blew the entire summer earning on this amp. And my dad was like, he wouldn't try and turn me into a doctor, but you know, he was a scholar. He would love it if I was a math teacher or something. He could not understand, being not a musician, how a guy would work his ass off for 2 or 3 months and spend every penny on an amplifier.
We understand.
Yeah, we understand. Everybody listening understands.
We understand. But yeah, I mean, and I tell you this story because indeed my mother, had this thing. And first of all, she would say often, because she was in a hospital for maybe a month at a time, the disease is progressive. What she had, as I mentioned a little earlier, was considered cirrhosis of the liver, when the liver decays. You can get that from drinking alcohol, from overuse of cocaine and other drugs. But she did not drink, and she surely didn't do drugs. What happened was, in those days, the major hospital, no hospital, tested the blood. They took took blood from people, paid them. Everybody from hobos, or what we call bums on the street, to whoever needed the $5 for giving up their blood. And they found that every single part of what the transfusion, she had a gallbladder operation, lost a lot of blood. And indeed, that was almost a death sentence right there. The surgery didn't go so well, and they had to give her a massive transfusion. Every single morsel of that transfusion was tainted.
Terrible.
And it was enough. There was no way. This wasn't, who's the guitar player in Rolling Stones that gets his blood?
Keith Richards.
There wasn't that happening in those days. So, they actually have cracked down on this situation only in the last maybe 15 years, because they were afraid that people were going to get AIDS from tainted. So now they do a test on the blood. But she was unfortunately not so lucky. Mm-hmm. And so, yes. And her thing to me was, I'm too busy to die, because I was having nightmares. I was very troubled. I had nightmares about her being dying. Somehow, because of my background of being a Jew, I had dreams often that Hitler was taking my mother and killing her. I couldn't sleep without the light on. Eventually got help for that, by the way, but I couldn't sleep in the dark. It's funny, because later on, one of the people I like most is John Lennon, and John Lennon had the same problem. He thought he could not be in the dark. He always thought he'd be in a coffin if the lights were off. And but my mom would. There's a story I recount in the book, where she had so much fever that the thermometer in her backside, her rear end, burst. And she was rushed to the hospital. And when she came back from the hospital after they got her fever down, she made dinner.
Right.
She made dinner. And I said, Mom, you've got to be in bed, you know. And she said, I want to live. Your father is coming home from work, and we need to have our family dinner. And this was this thing, and she'd be, on a massive amount of codeine and all kinds of pills, and she would get dressed in her best, and we'd go to the drive-in on Friday nights when my father's day job was over. It was family time. And so I believe very strongly that that gift of having my mother like that, my father with a positive attitude, being broke and broken, and still finding that hearing a bird sing is a joy, being able to wake up. And you're going to play Welcome Son, or I forget if you already played it. I'm sorry.
We spoke about it.
So I don't know if you'll play the track. You're welcome to play the track. That was the way he was, you know.
I don't spend the morning yawning. I say, welcome, son. When the world outside is lit up, I just rise and shine and get up, saying, welcome, son. I say, come right through my window pane. Shooing off the rain. Thanks for coming by my way. And thank you for this lovely day. When it's bright out, I don't worry. I get right out in a hurry, saying, welcome, son. And I thank the Lord for living, for the blessings I've been given, and say welcome, son. 'Cause I can walk and talk and laugh and love. Every robin song is mine to borrow. And if I'm very, very lucky, I'll say welcome, son.
I wanted to say, you made a point in the book, you know, that the bigger a crisis is, the more calm and rational you need to be. You said you need to be a lamb, not a lion. You need to speak gently. Speaking of soft-spoken role models, you know, you speak very highly in the book about one of the most seminal and iconic figures in children's television programming, Mr. Rogers. You know, apparently his trolley to the land of make-believe had a big impact on you.
It did, Dan. He's a... I mentioned in the book about a thing he does with a fellow who ended up in a wheelchair. And I remember watching this. I had been watching it regularly, actually. There's something about him. And later on, I was surprised to find one of his greatest quotes was talking about the silence between the camera, the outside, and the listener. It was strange because it was coinciding with everything that was happening in my life. And I was a freak for him. I watched every day.
He meant a lot to a lot of little kids. You know,
meant a lot to this little kid. That's for sure.
Well, he was a friend. He was an adult who spoke to them respectfully. You know, he was an adult who wanted to educate them and teach them about new things. And you said he was the gentle type of guy, but those are the people sometimes that have the greater influence than the loud guy who's yelling at you all the time.
Or yes. And you know, Dan, you being a musician and a composer, you would understand that there are people out there. I don't think in your audience, of course, but there are people out there that view artists in general as being living in the land of make-believe. My own brother, who I'm closest to, has a very well-paying job. He originally was a drummer, and when my father died, he took over my father's gig and something else, and... you know, he's got a savings and he's got a house and he's got a wife. And there are times that he talks to me like I'm from outer space. Even though he was a musician, he went to Berkeley too. He's 2 years younger than I am. But his first wife, who unfortunately passed away, and him came up with a name for me. And their name for me is Mr. Feather. They call me Mr. Feather. And the reason for that is that they feel I just float through life. I float if I decide. And I do kind of. I mean, you know, I have to show up for gigs and all that. But my general lifestyle is I do what the heck I want every day. And if I decide that I need to make money, I make money. If I don't want to make money, I don't make money. I want to go to the park with he'll call in the morning and he'll tell me, you know, I'm on the Long Island Expressway in New York and it's taking me 4 hours to get 20 minutes. I have to go to the bathroom, you know? And I say, Randy, you know, I'm sorry. I'm at the reservoir with the dogs right now, you know, and neighbor here who has a pet pig. And I mean, I must look like I'm from outer space to him. That part, that land of make-believe that Mr. Rogers went to, I translated it into composition, into inspiration. I might have seen the train go around and I knew he was going to go someplace and talk about some subject. But the minute that came on the show, I was able to dream. So Fred Rogers had a way of speaking to people, in my opinion, that allowed you to dream, allowed you to go on in a life adventure, sitting in your bed, your chair, whatever. You know, he welcomed you to his neighborhood And you were in his neighborhood, but you were free to be yourself. In fact, he wanted you to be yourself. He wanted you to be proud to be yourself. So here I am, particularly in those years that are talked about in the book, where I'm not proud of myself. I look like crap. I have dirty clothes on. I'm not working. I don't care. I'm depressed. I don't care about anything. And he's telling me, whoever you are, whatever trouble you may have had, I mentioned in the book about divorces, but whatever, whoever you are, whatever your life gave you, my case, my mother passing away 14, my father passing away on my birthday. I mean, those things to a psychiatrist are big deal markers. Fred Rogers said, take what's given to you and let them be a lesson for the happiness that you can find.
My neighbor, welcome again to this neighborhood. I'd like to show you something. You know what this is? Maybe if I press this button. This is a cassette player with a little cassette in here, and there's nothing written on it, so we'll just have to play it to see what it is. Do you ever imagine things? Are they scary things? Are they scary things? Do you ever imagine things? Things you'd like to have? Did you ever see a cat's eyes in the dark and wonder what they were? Did you ever pretend about things like that before?
Did you ever pretend about things like that?
Did you ever grow anything in the garden of your mind?
In the garden of your mind.
You can grow ideas in the garden of your mind.
In the garden of your mind.
It's good to be curious about many things. You can think about things and make believe. All you have to do is think and they'll grow. Imagine every person that you see is somewhat different from every other person in the world. Some can do some things.
Some can do others.
Do you ever think of the many things you've learned to do? Many things you've learned. Did you ever grow anything in the garden of your mind? You can grow ideas in the garden of your mind.
In the garden of your mind.
It's good to be curious about many things. You can think about things and make believe. All you have to do is think and they'll grow. Did you feel like going like that? Let's give the fish some food. Mr. McFeely. I didn't order any whistle. That's what they call a slide whistle. Did you feel like going like that? There are so many things to learn about in this world. And so many people who can help us learn.
And so many people who can help us learn.
Did you ever grow anything in the garden of your mind? You can grow ideas in the garden of your mind.
In the garden of your mind.
It's good to be curious about many things. You can think about things and make believe. All you have to do is think. You can think about things and make believe. All you have to do is think and they'll grow.